Paul Laverty trained as a lawyer before spending the mid-1980s in Central America investigating human rights abuses. It was at this time that he approached director Ken Loach with a screenplay idea. The resulting romantic drama, Carla's Song, marked the beginning of perhaps the most successful writer-director relationship in cinema. It is a prolific partnership, yielding 10 films in a little over 15 years. These include My Name is Joe, The Wind That Shakes the Barley, and Looking for Eric. Paul's work is often political in nature and seeks to explore perceived injustices, highlight forgotten individuals, and raise issues Western governments or societies are uncomfortable with. It is this unwavering social conscience that makes Paul so significant as a screenwriter.
You studied as a lawyer, and in the 1980s you were working for a human rights organization in Nicaragua. And I know in Nicaragua and other countries in Central America, you experienced war at first hand. Why did you decide to bring those experiences to cinema specifically?
I just thought, you know, by delving into fiction, you can go into another level. You can really try, and there's just so many more levels to play with. And in my innocence, I thought you'd be able to reach more people by cinema. And a book sounded far too difficult. I've talked to so many other writers and read so many other articles about how writers are marginalised, they're not included. Whereas I'm working with, you know, with Ken Loach, and he could not treat a writer with more respect. You know, so it'd be absolutely churlish to say that, you know, there should be more attention to what I do, because he's the most generous of men. I came back from Nicaragua, I was there for 3 years in Central America, and I just wrote to Ken, you know, and he just wrote back, said, well, if you're passing by in London, you know, pop down for a cup of tea. And so I went to see him, and he was remarkably curious. He didn't give a toss about whether I'd written before or knew about this film industry, which I didn't. And he just said, we'll try and write a few scenes. And he said, this is a real long shot. And so the kind of the first half of Carla's Song kind of popped out. And but there was a long time between that and making it, because Ken was working with a wonderful writer, Jim Allen. And there were several projects in front, so we didn't get around to doing it for about 5 years.
Did you get in touch because you felt from knowing of him and from seeing his films that you hoped you'd be kindred spirits in some way? There was something you could share there.
I loved the films, and you know, I knew what he had said, and I'd read and found out about it, and so when I met him, he was just remarkably curious and open.
We took it a little while to get going, and in the meantime, Ken and I were still making films with other people, so we did. When we first met Paul, we were doing Land and Freedom, and Ken had been very impressed by Paul's politics and decided to put him in Land and Freedom. He didn't do any writing for it. Jim Allen wrote Land and Freedom. But Paul, as a heavily, highly politicised Scot, was just right for being in it.
And that whole team is not, and not just Ken and Rebecca, although we're at the hub of it, I suppose, a little company called 16 Films. And so we feel like you're filmmakers first, and then we've all got different jobs, and then we meet together with different skills. Me as a screenwriter, Ken as a director, Rebecca as a producer. And then it spreads out to the people we've been working with for the last 15 years. You know, so Jonathan Morris, who's the editor, George Fenton, musician, Roger Smith, the script editor. So I feel like I'm surrounded by, you know, first of all, they're marvellously talented people, but secondly, and more importantly, they're my mates. So I think I'm just incredibly fortunate.
They have a strong system going, actually, of how they make films. I mean, they'll generally be shooting one every 2 years. While Ken's shooting a film, Paul will probably be out there researching the next one and having conversations with him about the next one once Ken's back from shooting the one that that he's about to go into the edit on.
It's funny, isn't it? I mean, people try to make it very individualistic, or the writer in opposition to the director, you know, and who is, or whose idea is it, you know, and try to nail it down as if we all do separate things. But it only works well when you're working together, you know? And when it does work together, it's absolutely marvellous. And I've fortunately had that experience, because I've worked with marvellously generous people, and there's never been a problem with egos or ownership, you know, we're faithful. It's like a football match, you know, you're faithful to the team.
For the last 15 years, I mean, since Carla's Song was made, you've written 12, 13 features, I think, and 10 of those have been have made by made by Ken Loach. Carla Song was the first one. The second one was My Name Is Joe in 1998.
There's a ticking bomb right from the very beginning, isn't there? You know, my name is Joe and I'm an alcoholic. And you just go, well, what's going to happen to him? You know he's had a chaotic past. You know probably he's had blackouts and he's missed, you know, 5 or 6, 10, 15, 20 years of his life. So now that he's sober, those things have got to come to the surface. So there's a lot of things implied. So you just feel there's a bomb ticking. And also you feel like as a man who's trying and you're on his side, you know, and that's not a bad option sometimes. I think it's good to have other characters where, I mean, there have been other films like, you know, it's a Free World, where the character is equal part repellent and positive. You know, but in this particular story, I think you're kind of rooting for him, but you're suspecting trouble. And I think if you have that tension at the beginning, I think it can be very, very helpful.
Would you say that the Glaswegian voice, if you're writing for the character of Joe, for example, is the Glaswegian voice the easiest one for you to tap into and run with when you're writing, when you're sitting there working on the script?
Yeah, by a mile. And I suppose I'm very lucky too. Ken's always, you know, really been supportive and helping with that. I find that, you know, because, you know, we've made films in Los Angeles and Nicaragua and you know, in other places. And, you know, I'm always just really respectful of the differences with people. You know, someone from Mexico City has got a different live view from, you know, a campesino in Nicaragua. Or, you know, someone who's grown up in Los Angeles. And so they're all very, very different. So you have to work much harder and listen. You can never capture it the same way. But with something from Glasgow, you just feel it's your natural rhythm.
He's just inventive, and I love his use of language, particularly when he's writing a Scottish one, because that's his natural voice. And I come from Scotland as well, and so it's like... it's joyous just to read the language that Paul writes in.
The day I actually sat down to start My Name Is Joe, I remember the blank sheet. And I just remember the absolute, you know, exhilaration, because I thought this man's going to bring us to troublesome places. And what I loved about the character Joe, I mean, in my head before I started, was there's one of the steps of you know, one of the 12 steps, I think it's the fourth one, he's got to make a fearless moral inventory of himself. And there's great juice with that. And so you don't know exactly where it might go, but you just feel he's going to take you on a journey. And I kind of love that kind of sense of excitement of not exactly knowing where you're going to go.
5 years later, my second meeting, Shanks, once again, dragged me to it. 5 very, very long, miserable years. I'm there because I couldn't take the knot out of that sentence. I couldn't say 9 simple words. My name is Joe, and I'm an alcoholic. And there's a wee woman there that night. Tiny, tiny wee frail woman who whispered everything. And she says something that was so simple. She says, I can no longer drink with safety. And that really touched me. Even in the state I was in, I was in a real state, and she looked me right in the eyeballs, and she said, remember, you are not alone.
The way in which he sets about writing a screenplay is exemplary. I mean, what he does is an idea will bubble to the surface between Ken and Paul, and between us we all decide, well, this is the one we're going to follow. This is the road we should go along for the next film.
You know, we're often sending each other articles back and forward. One day I remember we actually sent 2 articles to each other, identical articles, by total accident, you know? So there must be kind of some symbiotic kind of manner of working, otherwise things like that just, you know, wouldn't work.
Paul then would go off and spend 6 or 9 months reading and researching and finding out about the ideas and just making sure that he's done all the homework. And I think that's a really important thing for writers to do the homework.
I do listen and talk to an awful lot of people. I think listening for a writer is greatly underestimated. I think it's greatly underestimated for a human being. But it's, you know, people are happy to talk about their lives, and the great thing about it, I suppose what you're doing in a screenplay, isn't it? You're just trying to understand the world from someone else's point of view. You know, and, you know, you only see the world from your point of view, so to try and understand it just by listening to people just gives you great information and gives you new ideas. So I don't think you can copy a screenplay from the street. You can't do that. But it really gives you a lot more information, a lot more ideas. You know, if you're talking to a kid or someone from a different culture, a different language, a different sex, or who is much older, much younger, different country, who've just seen the world a different way. And when you listen and talk to them, sometimes it's absolutely remarkable. But I remember when we did Bread and Roses, you know, it was shot in Los Angeles. It was about immigrant workers coming up from Central America. They were women, spoke Spanish, meant subtitles. It was about trade union organizing because they were massively abused, and there was a Justice for Janitors campaign. And I met these people and I worked with them, and they were brilliant and absolutely fascinating. But of course, nobody else in the entire world of filmmaking finance wanted to make a film with women who were not well known, who were immigrants, who didn't speak English. You know, so for a film like that, you've got to fight very, very hard. But never for one single second did I think Ken was not shoulder to shoulder with me. It wasn't even discussed. I remember poor Rebecca O'Brien, the producer, when she went to Cannes in preparation. She came with more money than she left with. You know, it was as bad as that.
There's one scene that comes to mind in Paul Laverty's work is a particular scene in Bread and Roses, which he made with Ken Loach in 2000. They went out to California to make this film in Los Angeles about immigrant Mexican workers in the city, and it focuses on two sisters, one of whom who's newer to the city than her sister, who's been settled there longer, she's older, and the younger sister confronts the older sister because she thinks that she's essentially betrayed her sister and her fellow workers at the cleaning company at which they work by giving some information to a manager.
Eres una pinche traidora, Rosa. Eres una pinche traidora, manita.
¿Ah, sí? ¿Te parece que soy una traidora? Sí, ¿verdad? ¿Te parece? ¿Sí? Mientras yo los mantenía a todos, mandándole dinero a mi mamá y a ti, ¿te parece? ¿Dándoles de tragar a todos? ¿Alguna vez se preguntaron cómo le hacía Rosa para mandarles el dinero? ¿Cuántos años tenía cuando llegué a Tijuana? Era una chavita, ¿verdad? Y no se preguntaron de cómo, para qué. Rosa les tenía el hocico bien tapadito, ¿verdad? ¿Sabes cómo lo hacía? Taloneándole. ¿Eh? Andaba de puta. ¿Qué te parece? ¿Eh? Andaba de puta, mijita. ¿Eh? Para que ustedes no se murieran de hambre.
And I loved how Ken dealt with this scene because it's all coming from the older sister. So he didn't give Maya the script at all. All that she knew was that she'd betrayed in the first line, you know, why did you do it? And so that was her hearing it for the first time.
The writing is brilliant. It explores really grey areas between the two of them. We enter the scene on the side of the younger sister, and we come out of it understanding both of them completely. I think that's something that Paul does very well. He upends our expectations of where he thinks, where we think the film is going to take us.
It was amazing, Dave, going to Tijuana and Juarez and all these places along the border. We have all these maquila factories. And, you know, what was remarkable about them was when you actually go to the factories are state of the art. I went to see one of Ford, and they were making beautiful brakes and machines and all that. Then I met some of the organisers and, you know, grassroots organisers of the people. So I went to see where they lived. And, you know, the pallets, the wooden pallets that brought in all this fancy machinery, that's what they lived in. And they were working so many hours, their children were just left, you know, just to wander. I mean, it's an experiment of absolute, just totally unrelated, brutal capitalism, because you just they just work and then they're just dumped and there's no infrastructure, there's absolutely nothing. So there's no surprise in a way that one aberration breeds another in Juarez. You know, like, I don't know how many thousands of women literally are murdered each year along in the Juarez border. And then a lot of them drift it. They're working so hard and doing double shifts at the weekends, they often go crazy. They go drinking. And then often, because there's not enough money, they drift into prostitution. So after seeing all that and talking to these people and seeing the faces and seeing where they went, then you have the confidence, perhaps, you know, to try and write that and give a voice.
I think there's a touch of the, you might not like me saying this, but there's definitely a touch of the journalist to Paul. I mean, he wants to get out there, he wants to meet people, he wants to talk to people, he wants to research stories. That's not to say he then copies that or just brings characters he's met on the street into his films, but he uses all that to inform the stories that he writes.
You have to find something that's massively fresh to me that you kind of dive into, and also just captures your curiosity. You know, you're asking someone to dedicate the best part of 2 years or often more of their life to that project. So you have to ask yourself the toughest question of, like, you know, why this one? You know, quite apart from all the difficulties if you can manage it or pull it off or find interesting characters or a premise, but, you know, why this material? And I'm also aware that, you know, Ken has been making films for many, many years before me. You know, and so he's covered a lot more stuff. And, you know, sometimes I've been fascinated by something. He goes, well, maybe touched upon that in another one. And you go, oh, yeah, of course.
We try not to do the film we just did. We try not to do them. So it's what's concerning us. It's we want to do films that describe our lives or that tackle things that concern us as people and, you know, about the world of work or the world of, you know, I suppose you see an injustice and you think it would be great to see that exposed. But it's more about trying to find different angles, trying to find unusual angles to go at things from.
I mean, is it important to you that your characters are constantly contradicting themselves? They're surprising us as an audience, but surprising you as a writer as well, as you take them through a story.
I'm glad you asked that question. It's really, really important to all of us, you know, 16 films, because it's at the heart, I think, of what we're trying to achieve. You know, because we are often accused of being propagandistic, and we don't see the world in simple terms at all. You know, I mean, I love that phrase from Oscar Wilde, you know, the truth is never simple and seldom pure, or the other way around. But anyway, it's mixed up. You know, and that's the beauty about drama, you can dive into that. And so catching those contradictions in the characters are the things that we're always looking for and by far the most important. And I think the more complicated things are, the more interesting they are, because that's the way life is, it's not simple.
It's a Free World, I think, is a good example of that. What we didn't want to do was tell that story from the point of view of the immigrant worker, because that was too obvious. And to try and twist it around and to do the story of the woman who was actually, I know, bringing them in and lashing the whip, you know, that is a much more interesting person to explore, because, you know, what are her concerns? What makes her tick?
Why is she so cruel, you know? Why is she so vindictive? And that's much more interesting. And when things are left dangling, because there are no simple answers. You know, where you live, your class, your education, who your parents are, it's complicated and difficult, you know, and different for every single person. But what is obviously clear is the circumstances in which you live, the world of your story, you know, impinges upon us. I mean, all you have to be is surrounded by beautiful architecture and just how you feel. You know, you feel different, you know. And if you're in a different circumstance, what does that do to you? You know, or look at Joe. Joe only works because of his limited choices. Or young Liam in Sweet 16. So it's a key question for us when we're planning a story, is like, you know, where are they? At what point? And we have to be consistent and realistic to the circumstances which impinge on those characters' lives. And hopefully if you do that well for that particular individual, you know, as a ripple effect, and you try to understand how they came to be that person. I think there's so many stereotypes and misunderstandings, because, you know, good issues don't make for good films. There's fantastically wonderful issues around the world, but, you know, cinema's got to be more than that. A story's got to be more than that. It's got to be a great story first. And that's always the challenge, you know? So that's quirky. It's not something you can just measure or do. It's not something you learn. I think it's something you just instinctively kind of go for. And sometimes you might catch something that just kind of resonates in a way that you might not have expected when you make it. And sometimes you think a film is going to go much better than it actually does, but it doesn't resonate in the same way you might imagine. Because when you actually start the process off and the film comes out, sometimes there's 2, 3, many more years. In fact, Bread and Roses was 6, even The Rain was over 10. You know what I mean? So things chop and change.
Así que van a agarrar a los bebés. Lentamente. Se meten al agua. Los sumergen y los ahogan. Bueno, a ver, ¿cómo lo vamos a hacer? Lo vamos a hacer de esta manera, miren. En la primera toma van a entrar con los bebés y apenas lleguen ustedes a la cintura, en ese momento cortamos, paramos y traemos los muñecos que tienen allí, esos muñecos, y intercambiamos a los bebés. ¿Va? ¿Todo bien? ¿Qué está pasando, Dani? ¿Pasa algo? Oigan, diles que es completamente seguro. No, no, los bebés ni se van a mojar. Ni siquiera se van a mojar. Ustedes van a entrar, apenas tocan a la cintura, cortamos y entran esos muñecos. Mira, a ver, trae los muñecos ahí para que...
Sebastián, dame tiempo. Un momentito nada más. Dame tiempo.
Bueno, perdón, tenemos mucho, ¿eh?
This film was dedicated to the memory of a wonderful friend, Howard Zinn, who helped me with the historical research, who died 2 months before the film was finished. And if you ever feel like a fantastic read, he wrote The People's History of the United States, an absolutely brilliant book, and he was a wonderful, wonderful man. So when I see this piece, always reminds me of him. He was an absolutely brilliant historian, had a massive effect on many historians. And he asked me, after having seen Bread and Roses, if I would be prepared to write a script inspired by the first chapter of his book, which is the arrival of Columbus, this iconic figure, what was set in motion by that, the first priest of conscience and Indian resistance, which I did.
But did you feel, when you were first trying to write that film as a historical drama, did you feel that the more honest thing for you to do was to pull back and bring the filmmaking process into the actual story?
Yes, it was a device really, because I'm not interested really about films, about making films, but it was a way for us to have lots of angles on what happened 500 years ago. Actors challenge other actors about, you know, what the role was, and it challenges the whole notion of objectivity in history as well, I think, because by the mere fact of selection, you know, there is no objectivity, you know? You make a choice about who your protagonists and characters are, so I think there's a great nonsense talked about objectivity, and we tried to play with that too. And but there was one bit of material that kept me going, you know, when I thought we'd lost it, you know, because I'd spent so much time doing the history, doing the historical piece, I was never happy with it. But there was this first letter from Columbus back to the King and Queen of Spain, which is the first report back from the New World to the Old World, and he said, with just 50 men, we could subjugate them and make them do what we want. This was after taking their food and saying they were very gentle. And then he wanted to say something that was really, really remarkable, I think. He said, you know, right at the very end of the letter, he said, souls for Christ and much profit. And I think it's fascinating how we always look, you know, for justification for making profit. You know, we've changed in 500 years, but not that much. The psychology of that first letter was wonderful. I think today it's, you know, modernization and much profit. It's privatization and much profit. But they always need that moral obligation in which to exploit people. And I think in a strange way, that metaphorical 50 men, that tiny elite, I mean, look at the roots of this crisis with the financial sector in the United States, how they lobbied and put pressure to deregulate so they could make a fortune. And I think that metaphorical 50 people are still trying to subjugate us and make us do what we want. And so it was interesting reading the history 500 years ago and all this going through your head when you see this whole thing.
Well, I think for all the, you know, the heavy research element and even journalistic element to Paul's work, he does in the end make, you know, human dramas, most of them fictional, maybe based on things he's seen or people he's met. I mean, I think he is actually interested in crafting fiction and finding the emotional core of the stories that he's telling. So I think that's why drama suits him more than documentaries would.
He's unashamedly good at writing sort of description beautifully, I think.
I also feel that with Paul's work, he feels that there's a correction to be made in terms of what other films are saying or what other films aren't even daring to say about the world. And by telling those stories on film and by bringing those stories to cinema, he feels they can bring them, you know, to a wider audience, and to an audience that may be seeing another side of the story from other cinema, or maybe not seeing any story of that sort at all.
He's brilliantly inventive. He's very funny. He always surprises me with the way he'll take a plot. He'll throw in a twist that you just don't expect.
You say that comedy and humour is important to all your scripts, really. Because I think even in your darker work, there's always moments of humour. There are always moments of comedy.
I mean, this is something that me and Ken feel very strongly about, I suppose. I mean, everywhere you go. When I went to Juarez or I went to Nicaragua during the war, or El Salvador in very miserable, dark times, you meet people with great spirits, you know, they're going around miserable all the time. I mean, I think humour is a way of coping as well, but it's also very much part of us. And I think humour is a way that you it's one thing you can do. I mean, if you are powerless, you can laugh and take the piss and undermine, you know? And I think that's, I mean, laughter, I suppose, is wit, you know, and people use that as to defend themselves as well. And it's part of us. It's a beautiful part of us, I think, you know. A lot of the times making films is confusion, really. You know, you just don't know exactly what's going to come up, but you do have to follow your instinct. You know, like Eric Cantona was a wonderful surprise. You know, you wouldn't imagine building a film around Eric Cantona. He actually came to us, and he came to us with a real story about a fan who followed him from Leeds. So it had absolutely nothing to do with the film. But, you know, when Eric appeared, and we were both football fans, and he had such kind of panache, and he was such a kind of a character, it really helped me make a film. I always wanted to make about grandparents, which probably nobody else would have been interested in. I was kind of fascinated by families break up now, you know, and, you know, you're looking after other people's kids, and, you know, other people are looking after your kids, and poor old Eric, at this point in time, he's just fallen through his own fingers. He feels he's got no identity, nobody listens to him, and he just feels he's literally fallen apart and has absolutely no control of his life, so he kind of needs a friend, I think. And then he has an imaginary relationship with probably someone on the pitch who had probably more confidence than anyone ever in the history of football. And so I love the idea of throwing these two things together. You know, and Ken loved that idea, Eric loved that idea, and so we went for it, but it was... So you've got to improvise, you can't have like 5-year plans. You know, it was something that it was a lovely little present.
Eric Cantona was, would you say an unlikely but a welcome collaborator?
He was great, he was great fun. And he was also very modest and very smart, and, you know, he'd seen a lot of Ken's films and really wanted to work with him. He came with a different idea, very, very different from this, about a Leeds supporter who had followed him. But we're both kind of fascinated. We love, both love football. And he was a gem, and we just thought it would maybe take us to another way of telling the story. Really.
You must say no. No. Come on, say it. No. In French. No.
No.
Like you mean it. No.
No.
More, more, more. No.
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 From your balls. No.
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 Dad? Are you all right?
No.
I'm often asked to do these master classes, and it always makes me laugh, really, because, you know, master class sounds like, you know, you really know what you're doing. And you're a master. I mean, to me, it's like somebody who really knows how to do karate, or a master cook, you know. So I don't really feel I know how to write scripts. You're so steeped in the material, it's very, very hard to be objective. But that's, again, the great thing about working on a team, bringing in friends and talking about it, and, you know, trying to see how you can just make it work better. And it's endlessly kind of complex, and sometimes you're confused. But again, just if you're working with a great team, it's, you feel you just do your best, and then it's in the lap of the gods, and you're fearless about it.